Dan Mitchell. Check out his blog. He's a flat tax, small government expert. He's here in Australia. So I'm delighted to welcome him back to our show. Dan Mitchell, welcome back to Outsiders.
Glad to be here.
Good to have you here. Now, tell us, first of all, tell us what you're doing in Australia.
Here for the annual Freedmen Conference,
yep.
Glad to be here for it because it's a really well-run conference. I hope to be back, and all your viewers should go to it next year.
And it's libertarian, small tax. So what's the basic premises of libertarianism and the small tax thinking? Talk us through it.
Well, it's basically the Reagan-Thatcher message that government should be smaller, taxes should be lower, we should allow the private sector to flourish, keep government confined, hopefully as small as possible.
Why?
Because you'll have more growth, more prosperity, and this is what really drives libertarians, you simply have more freedom. People can choose how to live, what to buy, where to work, and that's something that some of our friends on the left, they really think that we're all like little cogs in a machine and they want to plan the economy, and whether it's sort of the soft core planning or the hard core planning like the Soviet Union, it just doesn't work over time.
So hang on, this all sounds really attractive, so why aren't more people signing up to be libertarians in droves?
Unfortunately, a lot of people want something for nothing. And when you have politicians telling you as a voter, oh, there's some rich guy that should be taxed so you can get something, that's a message that resonates with some people. And I actually think that this is what's called social capital, the cultural mores of a people. Once you get, say, like Greece today, where you have 60% of your people living off government in some sense, is there any chance of ever electing a Reagan or a Thatcher? So I think there is a tipping point in society where people just think it's okay to live off government, and when too many people think that, goodbye society.
Well, Dan, you're absolutely right, and we just went through what we thought was going to be that tipping point, this election that we've just had here in Australia, where most people, obviously not me, but most people thought that the Labor Party were going to win simply by offering more and more taxes. They were actually saying, we will raise taxes to unbelievable new heights in order to give you all these things. And the commentary at the so-called smart thinkers and experts out there said, oh, yeah, the people are going to go for this. This is what they'll go for. We dodged a bullet. Will we keep on dodging it? Or is the appeal of that honeypot that the left offer, is it too strong?
I worry that in the long run, it's a very seductive message that you can get something for nothing. I also worry about demographics. We're having fewer children in the Western world, and we're living longer. It's good, of course, that we're living longer. My gray hair, I want us to live longer. And people have whatever number of children they want. But when you have welfare states that are based on largely transferring money from younger workers to older people, and when that ratio gets imbalanced, that's one of the reasons why Greece blew up, and it's one of the reasons the next recession in Europe, I think Italy's going to blow up. And
wow.
The same factors apply in the U.S. and Australia. You guys are lucky with your superannuation system. You have some private savings for retirement. We have an IOU-based social security system, so we're going to be in deep you-know-what.
See, but there's actually a lot of people who I would consider libertarians here in Australia who think that our own retirement system here in Australia with what we call superannuation is really incredible statism and that people should not even be forced to save for their own retirement. So one of the things that I'm curious about this libertarian thing is you talk about cogs and social capital, how the left sees everybody as cogs. Is there a danger, though, that if you get government out of everything and treat everything as economics, then you're just making the same mistake of treating everybody as just an economic unit of production, and that's the only thing, and the social capital, as in Greece, goes out the window?
There is this theory, homo economicus, that we're just strictly rational, utility maximizing. No, there's family, there's community, there's all these things, and what libertarians and especially people like Hayek would argue is that you get better community
Who would argue? Sorry?
Friedrich Hayek.
Right. Tell us what he would argue.
Now, the late Friedrich Hayek, but Nobel Prize winning economist, who really looked at economics through the perspective of society and culture and evolution. And I really think he's the number one economist to read if you want to understand how libertarianism as a grown-up philosophy. Because, sometimes young libertarians, I read Atlas Shrugged, there should be no government, And as you said, with the superannuation system, in an ultimate libertarian fantasy world, should the government be holding a gun to my head, figuratively speaking, saying I have to save for myself? No. But what you have in Australia compared to the tax and transfer bankrupt IOU-based system
100%,
in America,
100%,
you're much better
100%, 100%,
off.
100%.
So,
yeah.
Well, I'm just interested in the next generation because we're seeing this trend in the US, the UK and even here where the research shows a disturbing number of young people identify or see socialism as a preferable model to capitalism. And these are kids who've obviously never suffered socialism and had the benefits of capitalism, but that is their ideology now. And, you know, some people say, oh, they'll grow out of it. But what if they don't? What if this next generation, this is the belief system they're going to bring to the workplace and to the polling booth?
My Democratic friends in Washington always tell me, we're going to win in the long run because old white men are dying out. And this younger, more diverse group of socialist sympathizing people are going to take over. That could be true, but let me give you one reason for optimism. Most people who are saying this, these Bernie Sanders young supporters, they have no idea what socialism is. They just think it means sort of a fuzzy Nordic welfare state, or they think it actually just means sociability. Oh, well, friendly, nice people are socialist. It's incumbent upon people like me and other people in the think tank community in the U.S., we have to do a better job educating people. We need to tell them, look at Greece, Italy, and France. That's sort of the good version of socialism. Or look at Cuba, North Korea, and Venezuela. That's the really nasty version of socialism, but it never works, and the farther you go down that path, the worse the economic results.
So tell us the benefits of the whole idea behind flat tax. Here the new government's got more, or the government re-elected is saying that they're going to start lowering taxes at the top end. The Labor Party obviously railed against that and said this is the big end of town, giving it all. So the Labor Party have sold the story here that all this wealth is being transferred from young people to old. They've gone that way and they're trying to reverse it and take money from old people and give it to the young. What are the benefits to the average person of lower, flatter taxes? How does it work?
In a globalized economy where jobs and investment can cross borders very easily, it's really critically important to have low marginal tax rates. And economists, marginal, what does that mean? It means what is the tax burden on additional production, additional generation of wealth, additional business creation, and you want that marginal tax rate to be low, especially when you're trying to attract investment and jobs from around the world. Obviously, you want your own people to do more saving, investing, and working in entrepreneurship, but I really think globalization has changed the rules compared to, say, 20, 30, 40 years ago. And Australia, you have to compete with Singapore and Hong Kong.
Yeah. And compete with the United States. And Donald Trump has cut taxes dramatically, especially in the corporate sector. This seems to have flown through and produced a huge amount of growth in jobs that Barack Obama said you could never magic that back up again. But Trump has, I want to ask you as a libertarian, he has done a lot of things libertarians would like, but I think on the cultural side, he's a culture matters kind of guy. Does Donald Trump count as a libertarian for you, or where does he stand on the spectrum?
Oh, he's not libertarian, and he's never claimed to be libertarian, and what I think about Donald Trump depends on what day you're asking me. if trade is in the news, I don't like him, because I think his protectionism is wrong. I think he's been weak on government spending. He's been busting the spending caps. On the other hand, he got a better tax plan than I think other Republicans who ran in 2016 would have gotten. And he's done a pretty good job of cutting back on red tape. So it's a mixed bag, but there have been some real achievements. And for people who care about the courts, that's been a dramatic
huge
thing. A lot of my friends who weren't Trump fans are saying, man, it's so good that we're getting these judges that actually believe in the Constitution.
Fantastic. Rita?
I was just going to ask very quickly about the protectionism. Now, that's one of the issues I've got with libertarians. You're so black and white. So how can you have just abandoned protectionism when you're trading with a country that has protectionism and, you know, you've got this unequal playing field?
Well, I mean, look at what Australia and New Zealand did back in the 1980s. You basically moved toward unilateral free trade, and that was a benefit. The United Kingdom became the industrial power when it did unilateral free trade. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't be blind to the fact that China has a lot of mercantilism and cronyism, and I would be perfectly supportive of Trump pressuring that if he used the WTO, where the Europeans and the Japanese would be on our side, or the Trans-Pacific Partnership was designed in large part to sort of curtail China and make them behave. Instead, Trump is motivated by this silly number called the trade deficit, which I don't think matters. I have a trade deficit every week with my grocery store. Is that bad? It's voluntary exchange.
It translates into jobs and production, so it kind of does matter. Well, and if China's got a massive advantage, that's
But hold on. When Chinese people earn dollars and they choose to invest those dollars in the U.S. economy,
China runs two currencies, though. China has an internal currency and an external currency, and so they play every which angle on us. And if every single American industry winds up going over to China because they've been simply bought out, then America becomes just a component producer or just surf to China. That's not good. How is that freedom?
I want Trump to pressure China to fix their mercantilism, fix their cronyism.
Absolutely.
Behave as a market-oriented economy. Maybe China wasn't ready to be considered a market economy for WTO purposes. You know, that's a debate, unfortunately, that already happened. But I think Trump is focusing on the wrong number, the trade deficit, as opposed to focusing on liberalizing China's economy, which would be good for us, good for you guys, and good for China.